Okay, here we go. We okay and we owe everybody else. So let's test it out. This is my website. I'm Paul Hall, and this is Paul Hall Art, the home page. Let's click Art Literature here. For this test, I'm going to go over Delta Bird. Delta Bird oil painting. This was one of the many canvases I did back in New York City in 1966 while I was going to the School of Visual Arts on East 23rd Street in Manhattan. I was living in a one-room apartment on Bedford Street in West Village and commuted to school on a Honda 50, 50cc Honda. I was getting 120 miles per gallon with that little scooter. That got me, and it was that Honda 50 that got me through the great transit strike in New York City, a time when nothing else moved. There was just no way the traffic was getting through there. So I had been inspired by one of my favorite songs, This Little Bird by Maryanne Faithful. In fact, I think I was listening to Maryanne Faithful album on my hi-fi, which we had in those days, stereo hi-fi. I was playing one of her albums. The only one I had, and it's about a little bird that lives and sleeps on the wind, so thin and graceful the sun shines through, that would fly so high as to be out of reach of human eye. So here he is, flying so high, and one of my favorite techniques is abstract. Oh yeah, here we go. This third paragraph. So Delta Bird, seen here so high that one can see the curvature of the planet, is so thin as to be practically transparent, yet it also reveals in its deep red a kinship with the iron ore silt in the river far below. This is a digital art series that I did based on the painting. I took the actual image of the painting and did several things to it. Here, making it look like a type of a bird, a flamingo or something. Here I make it into a glass mountain in a terrible windstorm. And here into a wetlands that becomes the dark black waters of a cypress forest. They're very beautiful. They're a plant, a tree that grows. A lot of these cypress grow in water, about 4 to 5 feet deep. Type of thing that you would get in parts of the Everglades, in central or southern Florida. And here it turns into a glass door. And here it becomes a stork, a pig, and a snail. Here it becomes a piece of jewelry. This is a combination of emerald and tanzanite. And here it becomes a Delta Bird painting, becomes another bird in itself called Delta Bird Flyby. And finally, it becomes a sandstone painting. And a button to be used for links on a computer screen, and here it breaks up into a flag, and into a glass paperweight, into an etching, a copper etching, and the flag breaks into a spiral, and here it breaks into another planet that turns into glass and then finally ends up as a glass paperweight, a blown glass paperweight. And let's see if I can actually do something with this. There's 15 of them. So, one of my favorite techniques is abstract expressionism, which borders on representationalism, because facing a blank canvas, I can visualize things only briefly. The expressionistic technique affords me the speed I need to set the idea and the visualization down on the picture plane before the vision fades, erased by the business of the day. So here we are, this is Delta Bird, and a brief biography. This is a link here. This is a picture of me as a toddler back in around 1947-48 in post-war Japan, post-World War II Japan, when they were still, the things were so inexpensive that my father, a major assigned stationed there in Yokohama, could actually afford a full-time nanny for me. She's away 24/7. She used to take care of me all the time. This is not she's away. This is my mother. I was running past in this one because I can remember even when I was a little boy, I can remember things. I was running past and she snagged me, put me in the chair, and Dad snapped this picture of me, and Mom had to hang on to me real tight because I was busy. I was ready to go somewhere. I had this above average IQ, so here I'm a little toddler, about 2 years old, 3 years old, but I was a lot older mentally. And Japanese was my first language. I spoke fluently with Shizue and other people such as Kuk-san, and they didn't speak English. So I thought it was all one language. And of course the Japanese disappeared when I went back to the United States. But here we're dressed in kimono. I love this kimono. I wore this all the time. Japan was a great place for a young boy to grow up. This is a part of my studio there in New York City, where I really got most of my artwork done. Let's see if we can go ahead and have a better look at this. I'm going to use the sliders here. Yeah, here we go. This is, I'm 19 here. You see I got my blue jean shirt on, a pair of blue jeans. Now, we didn't wear blue jeans back in 1965 that much. And believe it or not, this is long hair. I actually got some problems because my hair was this long back in 1965. Little bit of a library I have. This actually was a complete book of the works of Shakespeare. Here's a portrait of William Shakespeare, still kind of primitive there on the wall. This is a model at the art school. This is a premonition I had of SeaTac Airport about 40 years later. This also, SeaTac Airport, this was actually black paint on the wall of the encoding room in the basement of SeaTac Airport, where I encoded suitcases. There was come down a conveyor belt that had not been read by the automatic array, and I would scan them and send them to 18 bays, where they were loaded into tugs and into carts on, pulled out by a tug to the actual aircraft that were waiting out there in the hub of Alaska Airlines. But it showed up on the wall as a spattering of black paint. And this is actually a portrait done by memory of walking past Grenwich Gramercy Park, which actually then became a premonition of about 20 years later, writing an anthology of poetry in the gold fields of the outback outside of Tennant Creek, Australia. So you see, art can be used for a lot more than just making a living, for crying out loud. It's a lot more than that. No art, no civilization. This is I think this is a premonition of the problem in Afghanistan. This is when this is a premonition of the Russian invasion of Afghanistan before the United States won. This is a premonition of a dam in China. 20 years later, 30 years later, it was I think on the Yalu River or the Yalu River Dam. I forgot what this is. This self-portrait I did in the bathroom. This is a Koto Japanese instrument. And this is a quick painting I did of memories of riding the Honda 50 in the wintertime around the now non-existent FDR Drive down by the Battery in Manhattan. Let's see what's over here. Oh yeah, this is the painting. This is actually a painting done with Sumi brush and India ink. This is all that's left. This was taken years afterwards. And we'll get into that later, I think, if we look at this. These are portraits of Paul Cézanne that I did from a picture and a photograph of him in Life magazine. And this is one of his paintings in the background. Here's a portrait of Vincent van Gogh. When my mother passed away, I kept seeing her in dreams. And one time, she was very excited. She actually... Mother had given me a lot of support in my art efforts, and in fact she actually preserved these paintings that you see. It would have been long gone after that, you know. Well, after she passed away, she showed up in one of my dreams and she brought Vincent van Gogh with her. So I actually have met the artist here, Vincent van Gogh. I personally met him. He's in the afterlife now. This is like the real life, I guess. This is like a dry run here. This is all very exciting. So that's a portrait I did of him based on one of his paintings. So let's get back to wherever we're getting back to. Delta Bird. Let's see if I can find this... the English Girl detail page link. Here it is. This is the link to the premonition. I later did these paintings, and this is actually a premonition using this a portrait I did from my memory of me walking down through Gramercy Park. I actually did this painting, and one of them is a premonition. I don't know if the other ones are, but this one is actually a picture of this is the gold fields outside of Tennant Creek, between the gold fields and the airport. Out back, really, if you will. And I sat up there for 2 days and wrote an anthology of poetry called A Tenant in Tennant Creek. And actually, let's see if I can go ahead. And you can actually see this in the poetry section. If you go back to, this is my home page, and as you can tell, it's quite a home page. It scrolls on down here, and finally it gets farther and farther down until finally it gets to nowhere, and there's a lot of mysterious stuff down there. Let's click one of them. The Gold of a Scutney. There it is. Oh yeah, this is a premonition I had that I did in something like 1968. No. 1964, I think it was. 1964, 1963, my primitive period. These are actually balloons coming from Queechy. And this is a volcanic mountain called Mount Ascutney, a premonition of where I would live in Paddy Hollow. Is just on the other side. This is the Vermont side, and the other side is the New Hampshire side. And along the rim of here, along this bottom part, is where my father-in-law was later going to build, or help to build, Highway 91. So it's Highway 91, premonitions of Highway 91, or the cliffs of I-91. And here's a little drawing I did of the actual Mount Ascutney. This is a premonition of where I would get married. I got married in this bridge at this point. We almost lost a mother-in-law to a red pickup truck, by the way. They spent $1 million rebuilding this bridge, or repairing it. This is a railroad bridge over here, and this is Mount Ascutney in the background. This is the Cornish Windsor covered bridge, the longest covered bridge, the longest single span covered bridge in the world. I think there actually is a larger one in Switzerland, but anyway, but it's not single span for some reason, whatever it is. So this is taken from a photograph. If I had snapped the photograph a few seconds earlier, you see these ripples here, I would have had a picture of a fish jumping out of the water. That would have been groovy, huh? Anyway, let's get back here. So so that's that. Let's get back to the poetry section and have a peek at A Tenant in Tennant Creek. A Tenant at Tennant Creek. And there I am writing the poetry right there. This is the rock you see here. It's actually very hard to produce photographic evidence, but you know, it's because it's a time thing. But this is the rock up here. Right here, I'm sitting right there in this photograph. See, right up here, there's the actual notebook I was using. I have a mosquito net on because the flies are all around, and the mosquito net keeps them from getting to the liquid in your eyes. It's a water for them, and actually the tears are sweet, by the way. And the Aborigines folk have a problem with blindness because the flies go for their eyes, you know, and that is a bad way to dot your eyes. Anyway, I dot my eyes here in the book, but not here. Okay, and see, I'm wearing gloves and my shirt is down. This is to retain the moisture out there because we're in the outback. See, And here's this, actually a poem that I wrote, and it's in my anthology. My chair was never made by hands, but of the red rough rock. My telephone is just the wind. I listen to it talk. Competitors are just the flies my writing to harass. My office is the great outback, the future and the past. I sit here dressed in blue jeans and in a cotton shirt, the fabric for its fiber came from old Malaysia's dirt. For typing, I've an NZ Bic clenched in my white-gloved hand, stained ochre from the age-old dust of Aussie's iron ore sand. I am a Mr. No One, a swaggy, so some say, for I have come to visit, yes, but never for to stay. And though complacent argue it's a road without an end, I've got the greatest of them all. Forever is my friend. You know, it's a rough road, folks, but it's worth it. It's worth it. Actually, in this picture, you can actually see, I think, a kind of a light going up here. You have to tilt your, if you've got a laptop, tilt your monitor so it tilts away from you, and you can actually see a light going up here. Anyway, so, okay. Tenant at Tenant Creek. So, it's a privilege to get out there to Oz and actually do some poetry. So, let's go up here a little bit. This is button art. And this is a photo of me back in my, this is the last time I ever owned my own house. This was a huge trailer that I had, a Champion trailer, by then 20 years old. You see, I had all these projects on the wall because of my ADD. I never got any of them done. And there was supposed to be an audio with this where I said, Tempest Fugit. This is taken back when I was about 53 years old, 54 maybe, back in the 90s. Okay, so, no, back in the early 60s, I think. 60s and six coffees, remind me. I'm going to grab another cup of coffee pretty soon. So, let's have a quick peek at this other aspect of the Greenwich Village studio. There are some more paintings of the ply, filo, latch board, along with the balsa wood sculpture that I did. Sculpture's now gone, but all I have is a shadow of this. I spray painted it and put it on paper as I did it, and this is the only thing left. Is of what I call the whoopee machine. Little sculpture. I'm so surprised that I didn't get that much work done. This is a view from the bathroom window of my apartment in San Diego Avenue in San Diego, California, back in 2005. And you're looking out the window towards the left here. So I did the painting, and then I took it to art school, and Paul Hooper was on a 15-minute break sitting on the steps outside where I used to paint. So I asked his permission, he allowed me, and I did this little portrait of him fading away into the distance. This is a premonition of Bondi Beach. I was actually standing on this rock at Bondi Beach in I got to remember names. Sydney, Australia, back in 2000, and I think that was 2005. This is one of my New York studies where the telephone poles turn into gallows. This is actually a painting by Van Gogh. It's Arles, I think. And so you don't even need your own artwork to do this time travel and travel, because about 20 years, 30 years later, I actually was traveling through Arles on the high-speed rail from Marseille to Paris. It was like 1981, I think. So that's the story on that. Let's have a look at some of these Delta Bird things here. Let's see, I did 5, 10, 15. So, let's do the rest of these while we talk. Okay. This is Delta Luvium 1K. See the mountain, glass mountain, in the blast of wind. The wetlands turning into the cypress swamp water of, say, perhaps the Everglades in Florida. The Delta Luvium painting turning into a scene on the other side of a glass window. It probably is a real premonition of an actual apocalyptic scene. This is where the painting becomes a stork, a pig, and a snail. This is where the painting becomes a gem composite of emerald and tanzanite. Actually, this I think was before they had the gem tanzanite. You know, so maybe a premonition of tanzanite. You can use actual digital art as premonitions too. It shows its clarity. I have some more Let's work on it this way. I do hope this is turn out. This is the third take I've done on this. I don't know if you have the patience to see this stuff. Doctors have a lot of patience, but they're mostly the people who can afford it. I don't know how this new type of healthcare system will work. I haven't seen it yet. Fortunately, I haven't had to see a doctor since, I went to see one of them. So here's the Delta bird painting turning into another bird, see? Kind of neat. That's actually it's a digital artwork, but it's made to look like a collectible ceramic piece. This is Delta Bird flyby. This is where Delta Bird painting appears as a sand painting that would be like the ones done by the Native Americans. So different views of Delta Bird, where the sun shines through the bird. And Delta Bird is a hooked rug. That's a glass, piece of glass. And here, one of the glass paperweight studies. This is where it turns into a copper etching. This is where it turns into a spiral, which becomes crystalline. And this is where it turns into a planet. Delta Bird, the painting becomes a planet in itself, which then turns into a glass paperweight. Oh, this is interesting. This is where the painting, the digital artwork actually can be made to look like an oil painting, painted with a number 5 or 6 hog's hair bright with very thick oil paint. Kind of pretty, huh? And here it turns into glass. The lens flare added there. This is circa. Hey, the little buggy that wants to land on my nose here. This is I think this is a premonition of Firefox here. The Firefox web browser. You never know, it's maybe not. And here finally it turns into a glass paperweight again, a blown glass. Kind of pretty, huh? Of course, you really, when you get going with digital art, you really, to really be an artist in it, you have to be able to do your own filters. This is a kind of simplistic filter that was available with the Adobe Photoshop that I had, but it's very, very exciting to see this. I actually felt as though I should sign my computer's name to the artwork instead of me. This is a painting done by me and using Photoshop. Me and Sparky. Okay. So, Tempest Fugit. So let's sort of close this now. And that is Delta Bird And as we go up, you see, we're going to go, say, we'll say use this link to go up, and you'll see there's the artwork directory there. And the one I want to do next is The Night I Picked Up Andy Warhol in My Cab, which is more about me hitchhiking across the United States with $6 in my pocket in 6 days, but also to get from California, where I could only afford one semester of art school after I got out of my three years in the Army. Back in 1970 is when I hitchhiked across the States, got a job as a cab driver, took me about 2 years, save up enough money to try to go to the École des Beaux-Arts in Paris, but the U.S. State Department wouldn't allow me to get the GI Bill there, so I managed to get accepted to Oxford University by virtue of my portfolio. And I was there at the same time as Bill Clinton. Both Bill Clinton and I were both born the same week. We are about 2 days apart. He was born, of course, in Arkansas, and I was born in Georgia. And we both went to Oxford University at the same time. And also my history professor was there, Professor I can't remember now. He's not my professor, but I saw one of his lectures on YouTube, World History 5, I think it was. A lecture he had given Berkeley back in 2010. So, oh yeah, Professor LeCour. Well, I wonder how he's doing, though. Anyway, that's the story here. We have a whole bunch of other things. This is where, for example, the cantilevered walkways of gold. I think I have a picture of this. Nope. Premonitions of the visions of the cantilevered walkways of gold, which is really a carousel where all the suitcases were coming down from this chute right here to be scanned into three X-ray machines, which are symbolized here as carnations. And this is actually the emergency stop button pole. I actually used the emergency stop one time to stop the line. It's a long story, but I have this here, so I'm going to read them now that I've got this software where we can look at the work as we go. So right now, that's it for now. We're signing off, and we'll see if this one takes. If not, we got a pabnum. Well, talk to you later. I hope you were able to see it. I hope some people watch this. I mean, I usually go through, put one of these up, and it only lasts for, it only gets one or two views in like 3 years. But anyway, hoping for the best on this. Hasta la vista.